kingdoms will fall. Empires will rise. At the beginning of the Middle Ages, a small Turkic-speaking tribe called Ashina in faraway Asia established the first transcontinental and multi-ethnic steppe empire in history. These so-called Gekturks, meaning the Celestial Turks, climbed the political ladder of the Asian power struggle and became a mighty faction of steppe warriors just north of China. The Ashina then united all Turkic peoples on the continent, with its influence reaching from Mongolia to Eastern Europe. The Gekturks became the superpower of their times. Welcome to the Rise of the Gekturks.
The situation in Northeast Asia in the 560s attests to a geopolitical dynamic that had not been seen since the disintegration of the Hunnic Xiongnu Empire. Due to the campaigns of Mukan, the Khagan of the Gekturks, into Kyrgyz and Mongolian territory, the power of the Turkic Empire increased rapidly in a short period of time. The Turks controlled a territory that reached into Siberia to the north, bordered the legendary Korean kingdom of Goguryeo to the east, and was flanked by two Chinese empires to the south, whose rulers were actually of Turco-Mongol origin. Thanks to the secured supply of gold and iron by the Kyrgyz, and their control of trade along the Silk Road by way of the Sogdians, the Gekturk Khaganate became increasingly attractive to merchants and traders from all over the world. In addition to ambassadors such as Samarkos being dispatched from Constantinople to establish an alliance between Byzantium and the Khaganate, the Turks also hosted diplomats and religious pilgrims from India, Tibet, and China. Although the Sogdians dwelt in the western part of the empire, in cities like Bukhara and Samarkand, they had already opened up trade routes to China when the Huns were still reigning over the steppe people. Gradually, Sogdian merchants settled in the eastern capital of the Khaganate, Ötökin, and took over administrative activities in the service of Mukan. In the process, they also lent the Turks their writing script, which was later to give rise to the old Turkic script found in the Orkhon inscriptions and elsewhere. After the Ashina dynasty had lived for decades under the vassal rule of the Rouran and had had to adapt to the political and economic conditions of their environment, Mukan, following the example of his father Bumin, turned the tables completely. The takeover of the rule of the Gekturks in the steppe region had not been an invasion from the outside, but a revolution from within. The Ashina took over the political traditions from the Rouran, and this included the state form of the Khaganate, but combined them with the cultural traditions of the common people, who were called Turk Bodun in the Orkhon inscriptions. For the first time ever, all Turkic peoples were united. This had only been achieved by the Ashina, who had to have been aware of the influence of Turkic culture in Asia, for in terms of foreign policy, Mukan was also keen to use the extensive Turkic culture, which shared many traditions and rites of the Proto-Mongol culture, to the benefit of his empire. That brings us to the Chinese empires at the southern Turkic border. The Western Wei, who had allied themselves with Bumin Khagan, collapsed in the year 557. In its place came the northern Su dynasty, led by Yuventai, who had crowned himself Emperor Wen. Yuventai had been in the service of the Western Wei as a high-ranking general for almost 20 years, and as such had made contact with Bumin as early as 545, when the Turkic prince was still serving the Rouran. Thus, it was Yuventai who had established the basis for a Wei alliance with the Gekturks later on. Tai, or Emperor Wen, died in 557, shortly after the foundation of his new empire. But in the tradition of his predecessors, he held on to the alliance with the Gekturks until the end, and in the last year of his life, he even handed over the last members of the Rouran dynasty to the Gekturks, thus showing the Turks a final sign of friendship. His successor and son Yuvenjie died after a short term, as did Jie's direct successor Ming. It was not until Emperor Wu took office that a longer period of stability began in the Northern Zhou Empire. Under these circumstances, Emperor Wu pursued a more offensive foreign policy against the rival Northern Qi dynasty, who, like the Wei and Zhou, originated from the steppe. To achieve his goals, he needed the help of the Turks, with whom Emperor Wu had reaffirmed his alliance shortly after taking over. Then, in the winter of 563, the first major joint war broke out between the Gekturks and the Zhou dynasty on one side, and the Northern Qi on the other. The Turk-Zhou alliance approached the situation as follows. The southern front was led by Zhou general Da Shiwu. Da Shi's goal was to capture the city of Pingyang, which was located on the Zhou-Qi border. The Turk-Zhou alliance in the north marched into Qi territory by way of Guangwan. The Turks first entered Zhou territory from the northwest. There they joined forces with an army led by Yang Zong and advanced together to Taiyuan, which was located a bit deeper in Qi territory. Taiyuan was an important garrison of the Chinese in their fight against the nomads from the north, corresponding to its function as a secondary capital of the Qi dynasty. In any case, the northern Qi, then led by Emperor Wu Cheng, could not withstand the onslaught of the Zhou and the Gokturks. Whoever led the Gokturks in the attack had unfortunately not been recorded by name, but we can speculate that it had been Mukhan Kagan himself or a general who led the Turkic army into battle. Emperor Wu Cheng was apparently taken aback by the speed of the advancing Turk-Zhou army, but he did not stand by idle. He instructed General Hu Lü Guang, who is described in history books as the mainstay of the Qi army, to stop the Zhou attack in the south. At the same time, Wu Cheng marched forward with an army to Taiyuan to stop Yang Zong and the Turks. When he entered the city, he was so surprised by the strength of the Zhou and Turk soldiers that at first he wanted to flee from the battlefield. Only at the urging of Gai Shuowan, an important prince from Heijun, did Wu Cheng turn back and face his enemies. The Qi couldn't dislodge the attacking army, but at least were able to hold Taiyuan for the time being. The city was then besieged in the winter of 563-564 by the Turk Zhou army, but not fully taken control of. Only after the arrival of General Duan Shao were the Qi able to turn the tide and force the Zhou Gokturk army in the spring of 564 to retreat. At the same time, Hu Lü Guang's troops were victorious over Da Shi in the south. Thus, the first offensive by the Gokturks and the Zhou Empire against the Qi had failed to live up to its expectations. But Da Shi ventured a second major attack a year later in the winter of 564, this time on Luoyang. Luoyang is located further south, immediately adjacent to the Luo River, a tributary of the Yellow River. The Luoyang area has had a sacred reputation for its inhabitants since ancient times, and was also a gathering place for Chinese Buddhists. Da Shi actually thought of aborting the offensive, but decided to continue, because the attack was a direct order from Emperor Wu. The emperor had fears about the Gokturks breaking their alliance with the Zhou, as he had promised them some territory as well as loot from the Qi. This time, the Qi Emperor Wu Cheng ordered both generals Duan and Hu Lü to protect Luoyang from the onslaught. Indeed, the combined Qi army defeated General Da Shi's forces quickly. While Hu Lü could rejoice in the rise of his reputation, as well as a title given to him by the emperor, Wu Cheng had to worry about the fact that it was mainly the Gokturks who had attacked and successfully plundered the Taiyuan area. The Turks had retreated without suffering any major losses, and during the second attack by the Zhou, the Turks had not even been present on the battlefield. Ultimately, the joint Turk-Zhou army against the Qi did not achieve its goals, but did send a sign of the strength of this alliance to the Qi and anyone else watching. The alliance between the Gokturks and the Zhou included many conditions. For example, trade between the two empires was to be increased. In addition, Mukhan had promised his Chinese counterpart to bequeath him one of his daughters. The marriage between the Zhou Emperor Wu and the Turkic princess, whose proper name is unknown, was to seal the Gokturk-Zhou alliance. But the events of the Zhou-Qi war rendered the marriage difficult. In the spring of 565, Wu sent a delegation consisting of 120 people led by Yu Wenshun, who was his brother and Duke of Chen, to the Gokturk territory. The plan was to escort Mukhan's daughter to Zhou territory and then crown her empress. But Mukhan refused and detained Yu Wenshun as well as the rest of the delegation. A few years passed, and in 568, apparently, a major storm inflicted major damage on Mukhan's royal tent. The Khagan then took this as a sign of divine disapproval by Tengri on his revocation of the marriage offer, and in turn finally permitted Yu Wenchun and his people to escort his daughter, the princess, to Northern Zhou. When the daughter and princess of Ashina descent arrived at the Zhou capital Chang'an, Emperor Wu personally welcomed her and made her his empress. Now, we must keep in mind that the story imposes on the Turks a typical stereotype that the Chinese often cultivated about nomadic people. Mukhan is portrayed as a powerful and courageous ruler throughout the entire chronology of the Chinese, but apart from the perspective that we have just illustrated, he was also known to be stubborn and naive. Only after a great storm did he realize his mistake, and the Chinese emperor, unlike Mukhan, was of course merciful and did not hold any grudges. This of course had been written in favor of the emperor's seemingly great character. In any case, it is historically true that the Turkic princess did enter the emperor's service and as such became a Chinese empress. She is being described in Chinese sources as immensely beautiful and appropriate in her actions. Interestingly, Emperor Wu seems to not have favored her personally, as there had also been other women at his court. Only after the intervention of Lady Du in 572 did he treat her more favorably in day-to-day politics. Lady Du was the niece of Emperor Wu. She reminded him of the might of the Göktürks and that Wu still had to face his rivals of the Northern Qi and the Chan dynasty. The Chen state had been established after the collapse of the Liang dynasty of 557, the same year when the Zhou Empire was created. Lady Du wanted her uncle to show the empress greater favor to appease her home state, that of the Göktürks. While they had no children together and the empress's line vanquished after her death, this does speak volumes about the connection between her and her family, the Ashina. By 572, she had been removed from her home for almost 5 years, yet she does seem to have remained in contact with her father Mukhan as well as the rest of the Ashina dynasty. This woman proved to be the main connection and guarantee of the Göktürk-Zhou alliance. She thus proved to be of utmost importance for both the Turks and the Chinese. Her personal name was unknown, but she was called Empress Ashina at the Zhou court. In 578, Emperor Wu died, and his son Yu Wenyun took the throne as Emperor Xuan. He honored Empress Ashina and his mother consort Li as Empress Dowagers. This basically meant that despite being a widow, Empress Ashina both remained at the court in Chang'an and was treated favorably by everyone else. When Emperor Xuan passed his title to his son Emperor Jing, he honored Empress Ashina as Empress Dowager Jianyuan. Shortly thereafter, the Zhou dynasty was usurped by Emperor Xuan's father-in-law, Yang Zhan, who was to establish the mighty and infamous Sui dynasty as Emperor Wen. He had most of the imperial house in Chang'an killed, but for whatever reason, Empress Ashina was not to be harmed. This seems to have been a strategic decision by Wen, as he probably did not want to upset the Göktürks, who themselves had come into trouble after civil war broke out. Nonetheless, after having been bestowed so many honorific titles, perhaps Empress Ashina had gained too much reputation to simply be killed in the onslaught of Wen's usurpation. A year later, in 582, Empress Ashina passed away. She had just been 31 years old. We can therefore not speak of death by natural causes and only speculate about what made her fall ill. In any case, she was buried beside her husband Emperor Wu on April 29, 582. And she has sparked quite the interest of contemporary historians and archaeologists alike. Her tomb was found in 1993 on Chenma village in modern-day Shenyang. The tomb had been raided many times by looters, but some of the artifacts, including a certain seal, were recovered by police. Empress Ashina's golden seal, as seen here, is the earliest known seal in existence, being made in 579 or 580, bearing the inscription Empress Dowager Yuanyuan in large seal script. While this script was invented sometime during the Han Dynasty few centuries prior, it came into use during the Zhou Dynasty again. Mukhan passed away in 572 and was succeeded by Taspa Khagan, his brother and another one of Bumin's sons. Under Taspa's rule, the Göktürks rose to a superpower on the Eurasian continent. At one point, The Khagan even referred to both Zhou and Qi emperors as his sons. And lest we forget that the Turks now ruled the entire Eurasian steppe, beginning in Manchuria and the border to Korea and reaching as far as the Crimean Peninsula in Europe. But after the Khaganate had expanded to the west and east and now covered more than 6 million square kilometers, thus becoming larger than the Ottoman Empire some thousand years later, there had to be a few changes made within the administration of the empire. In the first year of his rule, Taspar appointed his nephews Ishbala and Bödö as lesser Khagans in the east and west respectively. He then switched his alliance from Zhou to Qi, as the Zhou Emperor Wu, Empress Ashina's husband, had just invaded and conquered all of the northern Qi territory. The remnants of the Qi dynasty fled to all directions, with Gao Shaoyi, a high-ranking prince of the Qi family, having fled the Turkic territory. When the Zhou invaded the Qi, Shaoyi made sure to stay in power, but was forced to flee from the incoming forces, and he brought about 5,000 men with him, to whom he issued the order of returning if wanted. More than half of his troops took up the offer and left him, with around 1,000 to 2,000 men staying. Since Taspar had Empress Ashina, a sister of his, still present at the court of the Zhou, he tried to be careful in his interactions with both the Zhou and the Qi in these difficult times. But perhaps the Khagan now saw the Zhou as a threat to his realm, since Emperor Wu's empire now stretched from the Gobi Desert in the west to the east coast of China. Wu thus controlled the entire other part of the Turkic border in East Asia. Taspar therefore accepted Shaoyi's asylum and welcomed him into his realm. At the same time, other nobles who had once been subjects of the Qi dynasty also fled to the Khaganate. Taspar also accepted their requests and transferred them to be under Shaoyi's command. Because when the relatives of Shaoyi, back in Qi territory, refused to surrender to the invading Zhou forces, they asked him in the years 578 to claim the imperial title of Qi and return to drive out all of Zhou from their country. Shaoyi accepted and therefore became one of the claimants of the title Emperor of Qi, giving him a casus belli against the Zhou. And in return, Taspar allied himself with the young prince in an act of geopolitical chess and backed him with his royal support as Khagan.